Hey guys, can you hear us? All right.
Okay, so we're going to try and put them up over there, right?
James, you want to find a bathroom?
A what?
Restroom?
Yeah, here, take this off.
Yes, yeah. Wonderful movie scene.
Can you see the slides, Francois? Great. James? Just sound again. Button and I have to arrange the items differently so that we can actually see Ithaca. Still working.
Yeah, I don't, you know, Windows, I don't really know how it works anymore in terms of getting to a control panel that get through this battery thing to get to the control panel. Oh, yeah, I'm not sure. This is like some IBM proprietary baloney thing.
I just have to grab him. The system will. Just hold on for Steve. He's stepping.
Yeah, he went to the restroom.
All right, great. We'll catch him when he comes back.
Here we go. Control panel. Let's see how. Where's test? Nope. It was on here somewhere. Levels.
Yeah, just if you move that around, it should give us a beep. Wait, yeah. No, I'm not getting it anymore. Okay, can you hit the test one more time for me?
Okay.
Great, so should
now,
be all set.
Now we got Steve's slides pack. We had to restart the sound for some crazy reason. Okay, let's put the mic on him and then let's go.
Okay, great.
That's good.
Yep, we're live there, and it's Mike. Sorry.
Francois, can you mute? Can you mute the mic there, Francois?
That's all turned on and everything.
That's good. I believe it is, yeah.
Excellent. All right, let's get started. Welcome to the last DTEC NYC seminar of the academic year. We'll start again in the fall, probably September. Shiri Azenkot, a new professor here at Cornell Tech, will be leading that. Go to bit.ly/NYC if you're not on the mailing list, or check the schedule so you know what's coming up. I'm happy to introduce today Professor Steve Feiner from Columbia University Computer Science Department. Steve and I go a long way back. Steve got his Ph.D. From Brown University in the really famous computer graphics group that's been there for a number of years, led by Andy Van Dam and others. And since then, he's been at Columbia, where he's done really groundbreaking work in a variety of areas in human-computer interaction and computer graphics. But he's most well-known, in my opinion, for being one of the real leaders in augmented reality, which you hear a lot about these days, but Steve's been doing it for over 20 years. And in fact, his group and students and himself were the first in the world to introduce mobile augmented reality with a see-through display. And I think you'll see that Steve has really looked at where these kinds of systems can be useful for people in different types of work tasks rather than just some random general purpose idea that you might hear a lot about today from people upstairs. But without further ado, let's hear what Steve has to say about it.
Okay, thank you, James. Assuming that my microphone is working properly right now, it's a pleasure to have an opportunity to talk to you about some of the research that my lab has been doing. And as James mentioned, I'll be talking about augmented reality. And just to make sure we're all on the same page, I will give you the definition that my students and I use, which is really essentially the definition that most people who do research in the field use. So what is AR? It refers to the idea of combining virtual media with our perception of the real world, doing it interactively and doing it in a way in which the virtual stuff and the real stuff is registered in 3D. Now, I try to be very careful over here by not being, say, graphic chauvinistic and particularizing this to things that you see, because AR in general can refer to things that you hear, smell, taste, etc. So it doesn't have to be just visual. Even what I'm going to be talking about today is going to be specific to things that we see. So to give you an example of AR, let's see if I can find my pointer over here. This is an image from a much older piece of work that my students and I did a number of years ago. Here we're looking at a photograph of a portion of what's called a space frame building. You're looking at a node over here, some struts that go into it. And this is some overlay graphics, which you're seeing just by itself, circa the mid-1990s, running in software on a PC, showing a very simple rendering of a cylinder representing a strut that's going to be installed, a little turning arrow that shows the direction in which you turn, a little collar over here, and one of the nodes that it goes into. Now, by itself, that's rather simplistic looking, but when that's overlaid and registered with the real world, this is giving you instructions telling you that a particular strut needs to go in over here, turn it over there to attach it, and then when you're done, we actually had a barcode scanner that you used to scan a barcode on it. We actually were tracking the position so we knew whether you were scanning the strut in the right place. So examples of something that people have been doing actually in research since literally the late 1960s. Ivan Sutherland, usually known as the father or grandfather or godfather, whatever, of computer graphics, is also responsible for having done, in the late 1960s, the first AR and as well also first VR research. So the neat thing about AR compared with, say, VR, in which you're looking at virtual things that are interactive and experienced in real time, is that the virtual content in AR doesn't replace the real world, it's designed to supplement it. And that means that one of the research challenges is because we are not ignoring the things in the real world, we're actually celebrating them. They're part of our interface. Is we need to design those virtual things in a way in which they complement the real world. It's probably the best statement I can make of what the design challenge of doing things in AR is. You don't have a featureless black rectangle or 2 or 10 or whatever that you have to fill with pixels that help you perform a task. You're looking at, you're experiencing reality. And you can't ignore it, because in many cases, the things that are happening there are more important than the things that might be overlaid on top of what you're seeing. So we need to make sure that you are attentive to, that you are interacting properly with the things that are happening in reality, both things that are unintended, that might be dangerous, for example, and as well things in which the overlaid material is designed to actually help you with. might be task assistance, for example, in which case we need to really see the real stuff or hear or otherwise experience the real stuff. So I'm going to talk about three different areas in which my group has been working. The first one is task assistance, maintenance, assembly, repair, other kinds of tasks, navigation as well, travel, in which we're trying to help you do something in the real world. And I'll talk a bit about some of the work that we've done with multiple viewpoints, in which the idea is we want to augment not only the view that you're seeing right now, but views that you might have seen in the past, or maybe even views that you haven't seen yet, giving you additional information about other than first-person views of the world. And then I'll talk a little bit about some of the work we've done with multiple displays, trying to combine together different kinds of displays to be able to make something that's essentially a sum that's greater, a whole that's greater than the sum of its parts. So task assistance is something that my lab has worked on since the early 90s. I'm going to talk mostly about our somewhat more recent work. And this image over here is from research that my former PhD student Steve Henderson did with me, in which we're actually studying young Marines working inside of a turret of essentially a small tank called a light armored vehicle. And we were looking at how they performed with AR performing tasks as opposed to performing tasks using more conventional kinds of media. So I'll tell you a little bit about part of this research, which we concentrated on what we refer to as workpiece task assistance. There's some physical thing in the real world that you're going to manipulate, and you need to be shown how to do it. And ideally, with AR, you'll be able to do it more quickly and as well with fewer errors than you would do it using other kinds of task assistance. And so one of the things we worked on was a study trying to look at a particular task and see how people perform using more classical kinds of media. Nowadays, we're pretty much past paper, and in a lot of high-end maintenance and repair and assembly, people use basically laptops with various kinds of software running on it that explains how to do things, and when they reach the end of a particular procedure, they hit return or press a number, and then they go on to the next step in a task. And then the question that we wanted to ask was, could we show whether AR was or was not better than this conventional, which nowadays means computer-based documentation? And so one of the things we looked at was an assembly task in the domain that I just showed you over here. We actually have an aircraft turboprop engine in the corner of our lab, and we use this basically as a domain for a number of the different studies that we do. And in that domain, we're looking at how to assemble one of the combustion chambers in that aircraft engine. And so that particular task involves selecting a bottom piece, a top piece. You can get an idea from the hands over there and the scale that this is. You have to put the correct top on top of the correct bottom. And then in our task, normally there would be 20 bolts that go around this little collar over here. But there's really not something that if you know how to put bolts and tighten them, that AR is going to help you with. And so in our version of this task, we just had two of these selected holes that were highlighted and needed to have a pin simply inserted in them. So this is the domain in which we did our study. There's three bottoms, there's three tops, a little turntable over here, some of those pins that I mentioned, and a little red button that basically is used to start and stop the experiment. We video recorded this, and we also were recording the position and orientation of the person's head as they perform the task. What I'll show you in a couple of seconds will be some video showing you what this looks like to someone looking through one of the head-worn displays that we're using. And one thing I want to point out is that if you look at these objects over here, you can see these little spherical shapes attached to them. And those are markers that are part of a motion capture system, literally the same kind that's used in movie making, in which we are using with a set of ceiling-mounted cameras to capture the position, the orientation, as well the identity of each one of these pieces. So the system knows exactly which piece you've picked up, it knows how it's positioned, how it's oriented, and we can use that to be able to determine whether you're doing the right thing, the wrong thing, to tell you if you're doing the wrong thing, to If you pick up the wrong piece, put it back, for example. If you're putting it in the wrong place, to put it in a different place. And of course, when you put it in the right place or oriented it the right way, we can also know that you're done and then move you on to the next task. Okay, that's one very important thing that you can do with an AR system to track stuff. But what we really wanted to concentrate on in this particular system was not the automatic tracking of things and the automatic advancement to the next step, but the idea of an AR having the things that you're seeing virtually be overlaid on top of what you're looking at that's real. And so in order to do a study, we wanted to compare AR with an alternative in which we also had this notion of being able to know where things were, being able to advance you to the next step, something that normally isn't done with conventional manuals nowadays, but something that one could argue could get done. And we wanted to isolate that out from potential advantages of overlaid stuff on top of those things that were being tracked. So in our study, we had two conditions. We had an AR condition. You're seeing one subject over here wearing this very big and bulky head-worn display. Many of you here are familiar with much lighter ones, like Google Glass, for example. Glass is a monocular display, one eye, one very small field of view display, off not quite in your main line of sight, usually not used for this kind of registered overlaid AR. And in this case, we're using something that is stereo, that has much wider field of view, that's directly in your line of sight. It's also tracked in terms of position and orientation. And this particular technology, to make that much bigger field of view, ends up being much bigger and bulkier. So this is our AR condition. Here's our LCD condition. There's a flat panel that was bolted to the back of that infrastructure you were seeing. And that's standing in for a probably smaller laptop display that would normally be used by someone performing a task like this. We put a lot of effort into trying to make the documentation that we used in this condition be really, really good, better than, sadly, what you would typically find in this kind of documentation. And as I mentioned, just like in the AR condition, because we are tracking all of the objects, we know where they are, we know how they're oriented, we're also tracking the person's head. Can't really see it over here, but there's a little light headband that has some of these same little foam retroreflective spheres on it that we're using to track the position and orientation of the head, because we wanted to be able to know something about where the head was and how it was being oriented during the task to be able to do some comparisons. And so the difference over here, the main difference is in the kind of display, the position of the display, and the fact, again, that the documentation is up here, the task is down there, versus documentation and task are going to be essentially integrated right in front of the user in AR. So I'll show you a video of what the AR condition looks like. Before I do that, I wanted to very quickly sort of give you an overview with stills of what you're going to see, because it's going to go by rather fast. And so among the things that we're doing in the overlays is we are showing you highlights. For example, here we see an image of someone picking up on one of the bottoms of this combustion chamber, and you see this little yellow highlight. There's a little yellow tag on the side over there telling you what the identification number of it is. There's a little spline curve over here that's kind of a stylized motion path of where this is supposed to move to. Here we see it placed at its destination. There's this big red arrow you're going to see in the video that's pointing to where you need to go and look next, that will move as you move around and look around. Once you put something in the right place, the system will know it's there and move on to the next step. And when you put the top on top of the bottom, assuming it's the right top, it's going to go and give you additional instructions telling you how to orient it relative to the bottom. And here we're seeing, for example, a rectangular blue J. Here's a rectangular blue 17. And you're supposed to line up that little highlighted hole over here with the highlighted hole at the bottom over there. So we're basically one degree of rotational freedom has to line up these two holes, put the pins inside of them. There's a little arrow showing you the shortest way to go turn the top or bottom relative to each other. And it goes from being red when it's relatively long distance to turn, through yellow, through green, ultimately disappears. And then when it disappears, you go from seeing in this close-up over here little highlights around those holes to the arrow disappearing, and then the highlights kind of fuse together, and then you put the pin in the hole. So So we're really, in this case, trying to, if anything, do overkill and providing lots and lots of overlays to go and explain stuff. So I'm going to show you what this looks like. This video that I'm going to show you is shot through one eye of the head-worn display. The kind of display that we're using is what's called an optical see-through display. That means it combines real stuff and virtual stuff using lenses and mirrors. And so in this case, the combination is going to occur so that you, the person looking through the two eyes, can see the real world directly through the lenses and then reflected a little tiny flat panel built into each eye that will show the added virtual stuff. Now, in order to really do that while you're really performing the task and wearing it on your head, I would actually have to have a camera right where your eye is. That would be kind of uncomfortable. I don't like to do that to my graduate students. And so to make this work and make the video work, we actually have a fiberglass head that is wearing the head-worn display. And the video you're going to see was recorded by having one person holding that head on a tripod, kind of moving it around the way your head might normally move. Another person is reaching around the sides. Obviously, that's not the way we do a study, but it is what we need to do if I really want to record what you're seeing through one eye of the head-worn display. So let's see what that looks like. So here you're seeing that red arrow going over to the particular bottom that you need to get. Grab it, because the system knows that it's right. It's going to tell you to put it on the turntable. It's there. You go and pick up the top piece. And then we put it on. And when it gets close enough, it says, OK, it's in the right place. In this case, we're kind of sort of close. It's a yellow arrow. And we'll turn it in the direction of the arrow. We're lining up the Q and the 19. They'll fuse. And then we go and put a pin in it. And you can spin it around, put a pin in the other one. And then when we're done, hit the button. So that was AR. I'm not going to show you a video of a person doing this with the LCD condition, but you know, they're basically, they have to look at the screen over here to be able to go and see the instructions. And then they're basically trying to mimic the position and orientation of the various pieces down at the bottom over there. It turns out that actually it's a fairly hard task, because just telling the difference between the different tops and bottoms is difficult. That was in fact made easier by the fact that we had, you know, a place for everything and everything in its place, and we were telling what place it was. So that actually made what would have been a task that was much harder if I simply had them just scattered around much easier. But then orienting the right way is a bit tricky, because there's all these little inlets and outlets you can see on the outside. You basically have to sight where those are and then kind of like eyeball them and, you know, look at the screen and then look at them as you're turning them to be able to go and line them up. So we did a study. Usually what we do in my lab is we try to come up with interesting ways of doing things that people don't do right now. We then want to do studies to be able to show that these different techniques are better than the ways in which people currently do them, or the and or the best way that we know of actually doing them, whether it's a popular way or not. And so in our study, basically, we, you know, very standard, we give you an introduction. We do stereo vision tests to see what actually can see stereo, which for this near-field task can be kind of important. As I mentioned, we had two conditions in this within-subject experiment. We usually try to have a video description of what it is you do to minimize instructor bias. Get practice block, set of trials, post-hoc questionnaire, etc., counterbalanced with this within subject as to which one of the conditions we do first. And so as part of a pilot, we came up with a set of hypotheses, and it turns out that we were able to show that AR was faster for the alignment and pinning, taking roughly around half the time that it takes to do this using the more classical kinds of documentation, but as I said, much better than the normal conventional computer doc, and they were automatically moving you on to the next task rather than making you do something to go on to the next task. We were able to show that AR was more accurate, that is to say, looking at whether you were within one half hole length aligning the top and bottom before the pinning, we were able to show that people were much more accurate doing this in AR than doing this otherwise rather hard task in the conventional way. And as well, people in our questionnaire also said they preferred overwhelmingly and thought more intuitive the AR condition. And one thing that I thought was rather nice about that is that this is, remember, what that headwear display looks like. That's around 1 kilogram worth of mass that you have to wear on your head. It's kind of cool, fun, but it's just, it's not something you want to walk around with every day. And obviously, there's lots of neat technology that's happening. I'll be delighted after my talk to talk about some of that with you. But for the lab studies that we were doing, we were going for the highest field of view, the best quality overlay in stereo, and this particular display, bulky and stupid looking though it was really the right way for us to go and do that. And people even like that in comparison with not wearing this stupid thing on their head and wearing instead a relatively light and comfortable headband. So some of the things that we're doing now involve not just a single person trying to assemble or maintain something, but a very common kind of approach that gets taken in a variety of industries, and that's multiple people working together, sometimes co-located physically, sometimes not. And there's a very classical way in which people work, in which there might be a remote expert, older, wiser, rarer than the local boots on the ground tech person who, you know, is going to be actually performing the task. And then the idea is, can we help that remote person advise the local person in the things that they're doing? And so one of the things that we've been looking at, and I'll show you a little video of this, is how we can have that remote person tell the local person where to go. That is to say, where to position their head, how to orient their head, to be able to go and perform a task, be it inspection or actually manipulating something in the task domain. And let's see if I can get this to advance. Okay. And so what I'm showing you here are some stills from a little video I'm going to show you. This larger image is, rather the smaller image, is showing you a view of a remote expert, sometimes called a subject matter expert or SME. And in this case, we're tracking their hands. We're presenting to them a little miniature, kind of tabletop size, scale down model of that engine that I showed you before. And here they're pointing out a position and orientation they'd like to have the local person reach. And then one of the things we looked at are ways of showing a person who's there without somebody else where we want them to go. And this particular approach involves a kind of splayed picture window frame over here, which you see in your environment, and the idea is you're instructed to walk over to it and kind of put your head in the window frame and therefore look through it. So let's see what this looks like. So here's our remote expert, third-party view, and this is what he's seeing. So there's a little lazy Susan that's tracked. We're looking at this little representation of the engine. And we're tracking his hand, so we can then point at one of those little indications of where to go. And here we have our local person. And in our third person view, they're looking into that frame. And now this is what they're actually seeing, recorded out of one eye, looking at that display picture frame representation. They look into it. And then what's happening is the remote person actually gets the stereo video they see. They can either look at it live or they can freeze it so they don't have to experience the motion of the local person. In this case, you saw their hand pointing at and depositing this little sphere over there. And here the local person is reaching out to touch it to confirm that they've actually seen where that is. This is part of a study that we were doing to try to get an idea of different ways of showing you things, both where to go and how to manipulate components when you got there, how different approaches to doing that would compare. So talk about what we're doing right now. This is a variation on that. I showed you that kind of splayed picture frame representation, which gives you a kind of fuzzy notion of, oh, I got to look through the picture frame, but I could be here, here. You know, could I be really far back? Well, there's nothing about the picture frame that says you have to really literally be that close to it. And so that was part of the beginnings of our attempt to try to get to the notion of being able to represent and visualize a viewing pose that isn't really, really, really specific. So for example, when you look at computer graphics, one of the things that we do is we talk about a virtual camera. And we represent that virtual camera by something called a viewing frustum. And this is typically a truncated pyramid. The apex of the pyramid is where the eye point is. You're looking literally into the pyramid, into the base of the pyramid. Usually that pyramid is truncated. There's a so-called front or hither clipping plane, so the things that are above that plane end up not actually being rendered for a variety of reasons that people who take computer graphics courses learn about. And the way in which you define where that lives in the world, once you define what its shape looks like, is in terms of the look-from point, literally a mathematical point, or as fine as we can do that with floating point or integer numbers, and then a look-at point. And this is defining a good deal of how you're going to position that pyramid in the environment. Now, the problem is if I wanted you to go to a very precise point and look at a very precise direction, there's some tasks in which that kind of makes sense, maybe like looking through a microscope. But there are many tasks, like, for example, maybe hearing this talk, in which you don't have to sit in a very precise seat and cock your head in a very particular way. There's many seats in which you can see a pretty good representation of what I'm doing. Maybe a couple of which you might be blocked by something, like if I'm standing over here, you can't see me. But many seats over there are perfectly fine. And so the idea is, can we come up with a way of letting you be told in a much more fuzzy way where we'd like you to be? And so one thing that we've been working on, because of this lack of need for the very specific notion of a frustum, is something we refer to as a para frustum, para as in going beyond. And the idea here is to have the same kind of truncated pyramid. In fact, if you're doing this in stereo, we'd have two, one for each eye. But instead of having a look from point and a look at point, we have a look from volume, where those pyramid apices can be, and we have a look at volume, which we have some rules saying about how what's in the look at volume relates to what you're able to actually see with whatever display that you're using. So, gives you a couple of ideas over here. Here's some examples of different versions of this. This is actually a visualization of this. Because the notion of a couple of volumes look from and look at doesn't really tell you how you're going to see them. This particular visualization actually renders the volumes as volumes. And here we're looking at one of the look from volumes. There's different versions of this in the set of 3x3. A little hard to see without the lights really down. But there's a little tiny, in this case, red look at volume. And in these images, we're going from the tightness of the position that we define. The smaller the look from volume, the tighter the constraints on your position, because your eyes have to be inside that volume. So we have big ones over here going to small ones from left to right. And we also want to constrain your orientation. And the rules that we're actually using say about the look at volume, that look at volume is going to fit within what your head-worn display can show you, and it can be anywhere within the frustum, literally, of that head-worn display. So a very, very tiny one, like this one over here, is much easier to accommodate, because it can be anywhere within inside, than a larger one, this one over here, which, if it's just big enough to fit, requires that you look at a very, very specific orientation. And in the rules we're using, actually, if it gets bigger than that frustum that's associated with the head-worn display that you're using, as it gets bigger, it actually becomes easier to satisfy because you only have to see a portion of it. So we've done a number of studies in trying to relate the time that it takes and the accuracy with which you can actually see things. There is an upcoming paper at WIST, which I will leave, if you're interested in this in detail, for you to see and read about when it gets presented. And I'll show you very briefly a little video of what this particular one of a set of visualizations that we've come up with looks like when you're trying to satisfy it. So the idea is we need to get your head inside of here, and we need to have you looking appropriately at the look at volume. So I'm going to show you a little view of what it looks like as you enter one of these head volumes, and then we're going to noodle around a little bit to show you some of the things that we do to be able to go and make sure that you stay inside that volume, look in the right direction. So here we are looking at it from the outside. We're getting our head inside of it. You can see these ribs around the outside over there. Now we're actually looking correctly. There's a very faint red thing that now is getting dark as you're going too far forward. it's getting cut off at the edges, and we don't want that to happen, so we're producing these little white things at the edges. When you pull back and those ribs disappear, again, a little hard to see in the light right now, that little red circle is just highlighting, essentially, the look at volume, so you can basically see what you're supposed to be looking at. And the idea is that, as I said, there's some tasks in which this kind of fuzziness is something that's actually fine. To perform that task, I don't need to be exactly like this. I can move around a bit. I can look around a little bit. I have some freedom. And the idea is we can show that, in fact, if you give you more freedom, more quickly assume that fuzzy set of positions and orientations, as you might guess, than if we really constrained you and said you had to be exactly here and looking in a very specific direction. So these are just some examples of some of the visualizations we're working with, both the kind that I just showed you and one that actually lives in 2D, kind of like a gamer's HUD representation of these same kinds of constraints.
Is there an easy way for the person authoring the content, or if it was a remote case, to actually specify this?
That is a great question. We're working on it right now, and we're looking at ways of being able to have the person specify. In the tasks that we've done, we have used representations that have used ellipsoids and super ellipsoids for the two volumes, and we certainly do not think of people trying to actually describe literally, like in a CAD system, those ellipsoids, but instead actually being able to go and put their head essentially in a set of representative positions and orientations as they're looking at the task to be able to go and make sure that they're looking at the right stuff from the right position. And there are also interesting other ways in which, if you know quite a lot about the environment, you can figure out theoretically what that should be rather than doing it pragmatically. So we're looking at those things right now. Another thing we're doing in the task assistance domain is going from that very relatively wide field of view stereo head-worn display. We're also looking at using glass, which is commercially available as of just a matter of weeks ago to essentially everyone, but very small field of view, monocular, off to the side. And what we don't want to do is to literally do overlays directly on top of the task environment. There's a variety of reasons why that just is not the best way to use a device of this sort. And instead, we're looking at ways of being able to go and provide assistance. Again, the idea that you're always able to see, as part of your field of view, the material that would be displayed in the eye piece without doing the same kind of direct overlay that we have done in some of the things that I just showed you. And so this is just a view of the beginning of an experiment that we're working on right now, and then a little captured, actually, directly camera view through glass of showing one of the conditions that we're working on and showing this kind of overlay graphics. And one thing you might notice is in this work, rather than using the camera built into glass to be able to go and do tracking, in this case we're assuming that if you're performing a task, you may be doing it in an environment that's instrumented. And so here we're actually using some of the same kind of technology attached to glass over here that we used in the other experiments that I showed to be able to know the position and the orientation of the head. And that's kind of nice because when we do that, we don't actually have to use the very small processor connected to the, you know, in some sense, even smaller battery that's powering this display. Instead, we can determine position and orientation entirely from infrastructure in the real world. So I'm going to move from that to talking a bit about another thing that we're working on. This is the idea of multiple viewpoints. This is a project in which we're looking at how we can augment different views you have of the environment. And the idea, think of this. Imagine that I have a furniture application, something that you, actually there's a fair number of people doing in AR. And what I want to do is to lay out virtual furniture in an environment. And so I might be looking at my environment, overlaying on top of it a view, let's say, of a table or chairs, a sofa or whatever. And of course, because I'm trying to lay out my room, I want to see what it looks like from different places. And so we might walk around, in this case with a handheld display, to any different locations, looking at what a particular virtual piece of furniture looks like. And then when we're done looking at this, if we like it or not like it, it's virtual, so I could literally I try another one, and another one, and another one. And unlike bringing something home from a store and seeing how it looks, here you can cart home literally an entire showroom worth of stuff. And you might find yourself walking around again and again and again in the environment trying to do this. So the idea is, rather than trying to do this from the first-person view, what if we actually stored the viewpoint as you walk around, then let you select a viewpoint from the stored ones, and then from that viewpoint be able to look at the overlaid stuff, and then as well manipulate it, maybe taking a chair or a table or whatever and, you know, moving it around a little bit because it's virtual, but without having to physically move to all those different viewpoints. So an example of what this looks like. Here we're taking these snapshots, in this case, walking around in the kitchen on our department floor. And each one of those snapshots gets presented by this little kind of symbolic frustum representation. And if I want to select one of them, we sort of pull back virtually, we aim our device at it, and then we can go to it, in this case, see in this rather ugly looking table overlaid in our department kitchen. And so for each one of those different viewpoint representations, we can then go to that location without having to physically go to it. And in this case, one of these things actually represents the live view that you see. And
is
then
a physical tag on the floor?
There is, in this case, a physical tag on the floor, okay? The reason that it's so large, let me just pause this for a second. The reason that it's so large is that the camera, like so many cameras, you can actually see the view over here, you'll notice that the lens is relatively wide field. And that means that, of course, whatever you're seeing through it is going to be smaller than you might expect it normally would be if you were looking through a picture frame held in your hand. Cameras, in this case, in many devices, are not that wonderful. And consequently, to be able to go and reliably track the position and orientation, we need to have something big enough to be actually do the tracking. Now, there are other ways to do tracking that people who work specifically on tracking for example, AR do. In which you can use naturally occurring features in the environment or known information about that environment to go and do it. And what we're using over here is simply another alternative approach, which uses these rather large, ugly-looking kind of op art black and white markers. And this one is big because we used a little teeny tiny one. It simply would not be able to be recognized and reliably tracked. It would work if we had four smaller ones that were sufficiently big enough for the system to recognize their identity. Each one of these has an idea coded into it. There are other approaches in which we could use a marker that was a lot smaller, and there are technologies that are commercially available right now in which as you recognize the marker and then pull the camera back, the system will automatically recruit additional features from the environment and use them to be able to reliably track the environment. For example, Euphoria, which is a Qualcomm software product, does that and does that quite well. Qualcomm, however, does not run under the Windows operating system that we're running over here, so in this case we happen to be using a particular older but rather reliable technology. But you're right, you don't want to have big black and white markers in the environment, and there's lots of folks working specifically on that particular problem and trying to fix it. So let me tell you a little bit about a study that we did to try to address, you know, how well is something like this going to go and work. And you're seeing the setup for the study over here. And in answer to your question, this is an example of using a whole bunch of those markers of various sizes. And they're actually oriented in a sort of crazy quilt kind of way, because although we ultimately cover these so you can't see them virtually, we really were trying to avoid your ability to be able to maybe line things up, as you'll see in this particular alignment task, by making them be kind of hard to actually align things with. And so in our study, basically, we had a little backstory. And the backstory was this. Imagine you've got certain kinds of transportation, like let's say this little train, and it's going to go from one place to another. And let's say we've got some living things like kids. And the kids want to cross, you know, a place in which they're going to intersect with a train. That's potentially dangerous. So you've got a stop sign. And you want to go and sight the stop sign so it's going to be at the intersection of where the living things and where the transportation are going to intersect. And in our task, we actually had three kinds of living things. kids and ducks and horses. We had two kinds of transportation, cars and trains, and they intersected six different points that you're seeing over here. And basically the idea was that what we wanted you to do is in our task, you're going to have, you're going to line up when you're standing, for example, looking along over here. We're going to have you, as you'll see, line up two physical objects that represent this path, and that's where you're going to want to be able to, if you're told to put the stop sign over here, for example, you're going to want to put the stop signs with lines up with the physical objects you'll see shortly. And then, however, that only gets the stop sign adjusted this way. When you're adjusting it this way, it might be over here instead of over at the intersection, and so then you're going to need to go physically or virtually to where that line is between the two trains, and then line the stop sign up that way. And our task, we made it so you really had to iterate back and forth and back and forth to make sure it was lined up correctly. And so I'll show you an example of what this looks like. So the first thing we do is we have you take snapshots. And the idea is you're going to go and line up, in this case, the yellows, and you're going to very carefully line up those red guys over there, helped by the little crosshair. When you like, you take a snapshot. And then you line up, for example, the blues. When you like, you take a snapshot, etc. So there's a certain amount of time that's going to be invested in taking all these snapshots. And having done that, then we had people both do this by physically going back and forth. We also had people do it by virtually going back and forth. So here you're seeing this little preview that's showing you basically what you need to do in order to line the snapshot, rather the stop sign up. And so now, in this case, we're going to do the virtual travel. We're going to pick the camera that shows the two guys lined up. Move the stop sign around. Looks pretty good there. Pick the other one. Oops, it's off a little bit, so we're going to move over there. Now we go back and check. Off a little bit. Off a little bit. You get the idea. After a while, essentially, you're going to line this thing up correctly. And then what we did is I showed you that little white overlay that we put on top of the table. If you looked around the device, you could see the table with the black and white markers, but you couldn't actually do the task. You had to actually look at the screen. And we really wanted to make sure that even if the white thing wasn't there, that it wasn't going to be really easy to line up based on the geometry of the markers that you were seeing on the tabletop. And so in that case, we're recovering them. And you really only had to go by, essentially, the what you were seeing through the camera lens. And so we did a study where, from what I just showed you, we had basically two conditions, using the snapshots condition and the walking condition, where you took the snapshots first. We had two tasks. We had the ones that were essentially oblique, which were lined up at an angle. And it turns out those actually are harder tasks than ones in which you're standing perpendicular to the table. So we wanted to classify our tasks in terms of those two levels of difficulty. This is also within subject experiment, which people were counterbalanced as to whether they did things with the walking, physical walking, or the virtual revisiting. And it turned out that overall, the snap condition was faster. And in fact, if you actually then separated things into ortho versus oblique, you actually noticed that didn't really make that much difference, at least with the number of subjects we had. That was not significant for ortho in specific, but as you can see, quite a nice difference in terms of the time for the oblique condition. But as I mentioned before, even if you combine them together, we ended up still with a significant difference. Now, one way to think about this is the following sort of high-level hand-wavy equation. What you ideally want is, if T sub capture is the time it takes to actually capture those snapshots, because that's something you normally wouldn't do, that's sunk time that takes effort, okay? So we've got the time it takes to go and capture snapshots, not needed if you're actually doing this the old-fashioned way. If you take the time that it takes to do the task walking and subtract the time it takes to do the task when you're doing it in the switching mode, in our case, it was faster to do it with this virtual switching. So that's the save time. and you want the time it takes to capture to be less than the number of trials times that saved time. Another way to look at that is that the number of trials that you need to be able to win is going to be the time it takes to go and capture those photographs, so they're getting reused again and again, divided by the gain in time for one of the trials. And it turns out in the stuff that we were doing, the time to capture was around 54 seconds for five snapshots. I showed you someone actually going around making them a few minutes ago. The time gained of walking minus the time to do this vicariously was around 30 seconds for the oblique cases. And so basically the idea was for this particular task, you ended up gaining after your second oblique trial. So clearly if you don't, you know, reuse the snapshots enough, you're not going to necessarily get a gain. But in this case, you got it after the second one of these kinds of trials. And then one important thing to mention is that notice the table that we did this around was relatively small. If we had done this with a room in which you had to walk around the entire room, clearly you would gain a lot over not having to actually do the walking. And if you were doing this, let's say, with a theater where you're comparing being up in the balcony versus down or mezzanine versus down at the orchestra, you could obviously come up with a situation in which the user interface could be absolutely horrible, and yet it would take so many more minutes to be able to do it by walking versus doing it by switching that you'd gain anyway. And we were trying not to have that kind of situation in which a bad interface would still triumph because you didn't have to physically do a lot of motion. In our case, it was a relatively short walk, just a couple of steps from one side to another side, and not all that many iterative snapshots. So this basically, as I mentioned, it scales with the number of times you reuse a snapshot, and of course it also scales with the physical time it takes to get from one place to another place. So another interesting thing, actually, which we didn't initially expect, was we actually got better error results. And again, you're really seeing this more with oblique rather than with ortho, but significantly better alignment error. So you might say, why would it be better, right? And the interesting answer, which you think is what's going on over here, is that to make those snapshots, you're really trying to do a good job. You're fresh. You line things up really carefully, make those five snapshots. And here we have a bunch of people who are doing a task. They're your typical students who are getting paid their set amount of money. And, you know, their lives do not depend on what they're doing. And if you're doing an iterative task where you have to go back and forth and back and forth, maybe you get a little sloppy towards the end, which is actually what we're seeing. And if you had done this with snapshots, and you made a really good snapshot, you get that really nice snapshot as you go vicariously from one to the other. If you're doing it by physically lining up and then physically lining up over here and then going back and physically lining up over there, people sometimes get a little sloppy. And so I think what we're seeing over there is the fact that by having those carefully done when they were fresh snapshots, people were doing a better job than when they had to go back and forth and back and forth in each case from scratch, actually have to go and line up the device to be able to go and position it.
Do they get sloppy over time, or is it just a little error in each of them and then it's supposed to add together?
I think what we were seeing, you know, I think what we're seeing is that they were basically getting sloppier over time. And of course, there's also the little bit of error. But again, you could have that little bit of error in the snapshots. If you made really bad snapshots, you'd basically be stuck with them. And of course, we told them you want to make good snapshots, and so, you know, they made good snapshots. And again, we give a questionnaire over here, and most people like the snap condition over the walk condition, and photo is less demanding than walking, which is probably not particularly surprising. So the last thing I'm going to talk about is not just this notion of multiple viewpoints and multiple displays. I have been interested, along with my students, for many, many years in the things we can do with what we call hybrid user interfaces, taking different kinds of interaction technologies and display technologies and using them together to complement each other. And so in the work I'm going to talk about now, what we're looking at is taking, in this case, a horizontal, rear-projected tabletop device. This is what used to be called Microsoft Surface. It's now known as PixelSense V1. Since Surface has been repurposed to mean something else. This is a rear-projected tabletop multi-touch display, And in this case, it's being looked at through a tracked headworn display. And so what you're seeing is a map. This is part of the Bing Maps, which is showing you the footprints of a set of buildings in downtown New York over here. And then the physical or 3D buildings you're seeing erected on top of those footprints are also from Microsoft. And they basically are showing you, seen through one eye, in this case of the headworn display, buildings that are the right size to fit on top of those footprints. And you're getting a view that looks very much like what people who sell stereo displays usually will put in their literature. Because if you shoot a stereo display as a static image, it looks just like any other display, especially when you show only one eye. And so to make things look good, they usually shoot the display at an angle and have stuff kind of coming out of the display in a way in which it simply doesn't happen. And in this case, you're seeing these things coming out, going past the bezel of the device. Because they're not displayed on this display, they're displayed on the headworn display. And so what we're trying to do is look at how we might combine together the multi-touch tabletop that you can just walk up and use. You don't have to have anything special that you're wearing to be able to see it and be able to interact with it. With, if you're willing to wear the headworn display, the added advantage of seeing essentially these buildings erected over the footprint. And in this case, in this demonstration environment, we have buildings here from the Flatiron District, and we basically mined from a variety of sources, Yelp, Foursquare, etc., information about points of interest. And then in this case, we're looking at one of a number of different ways of being able to display that information, in this case, little summary pictogram grids that are associated with the nearest building to where the points of interest are located. And in this case, we're actually adding in an additional device. This is a tracked phone, which we know the position and orientation, and we can use that information to not only know where the phone is, to maybe use it to sample things, but we can also make sure that if the phone is at a particular location, that it blocks our view of the virtual buildings so the virtual buildings don't overlay what we see of the phone. So to give you an idea of what that looks like, I'll show you a little video. This is shot through one eye of a headworn display. Unlike the last video that I showed you, in which we were using a video see-through headworn display, an optical see-through headworn display, this one is video. So we're looking through cameras. It's two cameras, one for each eye, that are attached to the headworn display. And you're seeing literally the view that would be seen in one eye of the person who, in this case, is wearing the display. So again, the buildings look like they're relatively stable because we're tracking the position and orientation of the head. And because this is a multi-touch device, there's a law that says that you must show people translating and scaling and rotating stuff, or else you're not allowed to show your video. And so we didn't want to violate that law. Here I'm showing you some of those little overlaid placards over there. And again, tabletop and the headworn display, and as well also the handheld display, are all talking together. So we can use the handheld display to get, for example, additional information on some of the different things that you're looking at. And so, for example, in this case, this is a 311 call or information about a 311 call where someone was complaining about noise at that location. Yes?
That application seems like it would be really naturally combined with Hiroshi Ishii's icons from the original tabletop thing like 50 years ago.
Right.
The urban planner actually moving things around physically, given but actually seeing them.
Being able to physically feel stuff is great, but as we know, there's pluses and minuses to FICONs, right? And they're wonderful if they're all special. They look like they're real buildings, but then you can lose
like
them. And yeah.
Your graphic.
Yes.
For you, you they would just come packed.
Right.
And
right.
I would see the building, but actually.
That works really nicely when you can have certain things like buildings that can be well represented by a set of sort of relatively standard shapes, especially for the base. Okay, and so it's absolutely right. There's something people often refer to as tangible augmented reality, which often refers to holding a cardboard thing with some kind of trackable on it that then gets used to stand in for something like a little let's say, a virtual model of a car, for example, but people also do this with things that have a more interesting shape that you can then grab hold of and move around and do stuff with. And yeah, absolutely. Having a base, and then especially if I pick it up by the base and I don't, the rules are I can't touch the top of the building, and therefore I can have one base I can physically pick up and move around all over the place, and yet I've got this building on top that, of course, I can't really touch because, you know, the same base would be used for lots of other buildings. Yeah, really, really great use for that kind of stuff. So I've talked a bit about path assistance, multiple viewpoints, and multiple displays in some of the stuff that my lab is doing. And at this point, I think I've reached the end of the talk, and I'm going to acknowledge my students and colleagues that have participated in the work and funding agencies that have helped fund it. If I have time, I'd be delighted to take questions. Thank you. Yes?
In what major ways the AR and VR are different? Uh-huh. Digital reality is eventually emerging
one. Okay, well, eventually merged is interesting because the two realities actually started as one. The very, very first VR system was also the very, very first AR system. So this is work that was first published in 1968 by Ivan Sutherland in a paper, seminal paper on a 3D head-mounted display. And that display was actually claimed by VR folks. That's the first VR system. AR folks will tell you that's the first AR system. Stereo optical see-through display tracked by a mechanical tracker known as a sword of Damocles that literally came down from the ceiling with the display mounted on it, or you could detach it from that, and there was an ultrasonic tracker that they used as well that was wireless. With 1968 was not full color interactor 3D graphics, it was monochrome vector graphics. And in fact, by the time it moved to University of Utah, one of the eyes wasn't working, and the hardware vector generator wasn't working, and all their vectors, if you look at the pictures, were actually little dots, because that was the way they got more vectors when you only had software generating them. Absolutely amazingly heroic and wonderful work. And the cool thing about AR is that if we are presenting it to you in a way in which you're either through video seeing the real world, well, if I simply get rid of the AR, it's completely regular reality, but seen through a camera. If I get rid of every vestige of the real world by making every pixel be purely virtual, then it's VR. And there is literally a virtuality reality continuum that people talk about due to Paul Milgram, in which on one end you've got the real world, and the other end you've got the completely virtual world, and then you've got what Paul referred to as augmented reality on one end, which again is a term that actually is a little bit older than that. And then the other end, you had augmented virtuality, in which you've got mostly a real, mostly virtual stuff with a little bit of real stuff thrown in. Nowadays, people mostly talk about augmented reality. Sometimes you'll hear mediated reality, for example, or diminished reality. But the idea that they really are part of a continuum and the same display that could present reality, if it can, at a given pixel, present only virtual stuff, and I can do that for each pixel, I can go into a virtual reality instantly. And in fact, if I take the AR device of any sort, whether it uses cameras or whether it uses optical combination, and I just put a hood over you, or maybe I just turn the lights out, then if it's a visual system, you're going to see only the virtual stuff. So absolutely, they're kind of the same thing, but with that important difference that if you really care about the real world, then you have to pay a lot of attention to it in ways in which people mostly don't do in VR. By the way, the one interesting thing is if everyone here know what a cave is, okay, big room with typically projected walls. Usually, people will refer to that as virtual reality. When you're in a cave and you look at your hand, you see your hand. There's someone else in the cave, you see them. They're real, okay? And, of course, the walls, you try not to see them. The best caves, it's really hard to see where the walls are. But reality, you really are getting an AR view because there's real stuff. People, you look down, you see your own feet, for example, your own hands, as well as also all the augmented stuff. Okay, so depending on how you look at it, a lot of those things that we think of as being VR, they're really AR. Yes?
So question on your course part of task learning.
Yes.
This is more regarding the speed of the task, how quickly they learn.
Sure.
I presume these were kind of naive learners who were not doing the task at all. First time, n equals 0. What happens if you continue doing them the same task at n equals 5?
Yes.
How does it change?
Okay, that's a great question. So in what I showed you over there, you saw lots and lots of augmentations. I even gave you a couple of slides where I said, this is going to go by really fast, so let me show you what they look like as stills. The first time I show that, that'd be great. The second time I show it to you, you might say, okay, I think I'm getting this. The third or fourth or fifth time, every time I want you to put the thing in the same Lazy Susan in front of me, imagine if I were telling you how to do something, right, and I kept on saying, and put it right in front of you. You'd, after a certain amount of time, you'd either walk out or punch me, right? And so clearly you need to adapt. We can't tell you the same thing again and again and again. And in fact, what were we doing over there? We had like everything but the kitchen sink, literally, in the augments. And you don't need those. You could even argue that in that particular case, I really did not need those even the first time, at least all of them, even the first time. And it's one thing that we're very interested in exploring is which things are really helpful, which things are kind of cool to show in a video but aren't really that useful, and as you learn over time, which things can I pull away? Now, there's actually a related question, which I'll ask myself, and that's that there's a concern about de-skilling. So if I give you something in which everything is augmented, I'm showing you what to do, you worry a little bit, you get something a little bit like that scene in WALL-E where all the technology goes off and you have a bunch of these people kind of like wandering around and capable of dealing with the world. You don't want that. And so one interesting issue, one problem that can be addressed, should be addressed, is how do you create augmentations that make sure that you don't end up being completely clueless and incapable when the augmentations aren't there. Things will break. Technology will break. And in the military, when they teach people how to use really, really neat technology, they really want to make sure that if it gets shot by a bullet or gets left behind when you have to leave really quickly or the battery runs out, that you're not going to be standing in a desert going, you know, is north, right? That you learn about the stars and you learn about where the sun comes up and you learn things that essentially can't get broken, so to speak. And so I think we really need the same kind of thing over there. And what I showed you wasn't really addressing that. Yes?
Yeah, so I mean, I really like this work, but I sort of come to this from a design perspective.
Okay.
And I think one of the things that when I see this, I mean, I understand all these formal studies and all that, But I mean, when I see this kind of work, I see an interface with a lot of interface ideas, but I don't hear much, you don't talk much about where those interface ideas come from, where the metaphors come from, how the design of the actual interface happens. And it seems to me that all these people are actually using the interface to do something, not using augmented reality. So how do you know that there isn't small things in the actual interface?
Yes.
That makes all the difference.
I mean, okay, that's a great question. So one of the things, you could argue whether or not it's small, when I talked about that study that we did with the conventional documentation versus AR, one of the things that was very, very unconventional about the conventional documentation is that when you picked something up, if you picked the wrong thing up, the system told you. Normally that would not happen in a conventional paper or electronic manual. And so that very big issue of having the system automatically track stuff, know when it's done, know when you're doing the wrong thing, tell you to go back if you're doing the wrong thing, that's something that you can get in an AR system that knows about your head position and orientation, knows about the status of the stuff in the environment. We wanted to make sure that when we did the comparison that we were not essentially seeing the advantages of that as opposed to advantages of overlay. But you're right, I could do really horrible AR, and I could clearly show that it was worse. I could do better AR, and I could show probably that it was even better. I'm certainly not claiming that what we showed was necessarily the best. If anything, there may well be augments that we added that were clutter, that really weren't helping, that were only cluttering your environment. And as I said, I suspect, in fact, I know that if you did those tests again and again and again, a lot of the things I showed you that might be helpful at first would definitely turn into clutter. But while we did a number of formative studies, and what I'm showing you is what we came up with over time, I'm not talking about some of the things that we tried that didn't work as well. You know, there was obviously an iterative design process in doing the things that we worked on to try to come up with things that were better versus worse. I just didn't have the time to talk about that. The light to talk about it afterwards.
So, sort of related question in a different field. Mm-hmm. I saw Barbara Tversky as co-op on all
yes.
these things. I'm uh-huh. wondering, you know, she's an expert in bioinformatic reasoning
mm-hmm. yes.
psychology. And mm-hmm. how has her collaboration with you kind of changed the way that you look at it?
That's a great question. So I'm not a psychologist, and yet I've been doing for a while studies. And to have someone who has done them for a lot longer, who comes at things with the eyes of a cognitive scientist and the brain of a cognitive scientist, and who knows about stuff where I'd say, gee, I wonder if, and she can say, oh yeah, I did that study 20 years ago that shows. You know, that has just had a profound influence in how we think about things and you know, what we end up coming up with. And so while my students are actually doing a lot of the design in this case of the techniques that we're using, they're doing it with Barbara's input, and she's puts on the headboard display, tries things, you know, says she likes something or doesn't like it, why she doesn't like it, you know, what we might be able to go and do differently. And it's just a great, you know, opportunity to work with someone who comes from this incredibly deep background in stuff that I will not pretend to have that background in. So it's just been really amazing.
Well, we have to wrap that up. Thanks, Steve, again. Thank you. Thank you.